Okay, next, may I give microphone to Ajahn Dr. Virathai and Chantham Seth. We will have just until 5:30 to understand something about Buddhists in India through our Indian friend, Mr. Chantham Seth. May Ajahn Virathai going on rapidly, and 5:30 we have to stop.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bancha. Most Venerable Rinpoche, Most Venerable Mahathera, Geshes, monks, ladies and gentlemen, please, with your permission, allow me to moderate the next sessions, which I believe will be another exciting sessions because we have very unique opportunity to have Mr. Chantham Seth with us today. Professor Samdong Rinpoche mentioned that indeed, if we are going to give a nationality to Buddhism, there is only one Buddhism, which is Indian Buddhism. In these sessions, we will have an opportunity to learn about Buddhism in India, contemporaneous Buddhism in India. As we know that Buddhism, for a long time, disappeared from India and prospered elsewhere. But today, there are quite a number of movements to restore back Buddhism in India. Maybe I would start by asking Kun Chantham to explain about the current developments, the contemporaneous movements of Buddhism in India.
So, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here at this, I think, very important dialogue between the Tibetan Buddhists and the Thai Buddhists. And though India claims to be the cradle of Buddhism, we unfortunately lost Buddhism in our own country in the 13th century, or even before that to some degree. And so what my friend is asking really is what is the situation of Buddhism today? You know, when we got independence in 1947, there were two very important people in India who in some ways showed the path, or at least helped the path of Buddhism to come about. One was the first Prime Minister Nehru, and the other was a man called Ambedkar, Babasaheb Ambedkar. Nehru came from a very liberal background, and Ambedkar came from a so-called untouchable background. So in fact, if you look at the symbols of India today, you have on the flag the Dhamma Chakra, the national emblem is the, you know, the four lions of Ashoka. In fact, when the first parliament met in the Lok Sabha, what we call the lower house in parliament, there was a statue put on the speaker's table. And they had a lot of discussion what statue they should put, Shiva or somebody, and they put Buddha. So everyone in the whole assembly bowed to the Buddha. And like this, there were many other, even the symbol of national tourism is a symbol of the elephant holding a lotus, which is again from Ajanta. So many, many things have come through from our Buddhist past. But the population of Buddhism at the time of independence was 180,000. That's it. But that is 1951 census. 1961 census, we had a population of 3.2 million. So what happened? There was a huge increase suddenly. And it was primarily because of Dr. Ambedkar. He was a man who had come up from an untouchable background. He'd studied the many religions. He was really disenchanted by the caste system of Hinduism, and he committed that he would not die a Hindu. And so he studied Sikhism, Christianity, Islam, and went to Buddhism. And that is how, when he converted in 1956, 380,000 people converted with him. Today in India, 90% of the Buddhists in India are Ambedkar Buddhists. Why I say Ambedkar Buddhists is because it's important to understand that it is a political and social movement, not just a spiritual movement. Just one example of that is that the cause of suffering that we see, what we often talk of as internal angst, is, in his case, caused by external conditions, the social, political. So his manifesto in some ways, or mantra, was educate, which we spoke about, organize and agitate. So when you think of suffering coming from outside, it's a different type of Buddhism. The rest of Buddhism, which has been going on for many years, there's also, of course, Buddhism coming from the past, There are people in Bengal who have been Buddhist for many years. We have people like the Chakmas, the refugees who live mainly in the Chittagong Hill tribes, also in India. We have movements that have grown together, like the Mahabodhi Society, which was set up by Anagarika Dharmapala in a small way in 1891. We have more modern movements now. Of course, we've had the whole tradition of the Himalayan Buddhism. We've heard a lot today already, the whole Himalayan Buddhism, which is now exists in Arunachal Pradesh and Sikkim and Himachal Pradesh. That has been a continuous tradition since the 7th century. But there was a new input, partly from the Tibetans who came in 1959. We now have about 100,000 Tibetans, and we are hearing a lot about that, so I don't need to go into that. But the Tibetans are situated across India, but mainly in Himachal Pradesh in the north, and then West Bengal and Arunachal Pradesh in the east, Karnataka in the south, Uttarakhand in the north. So they're spread out in many, many centers. They were given refuge into India. And it's been a great benefit to India that the Tibetans have come. And I'm just giving an overview picture. And then we have new Buddhists, people who are interested in Buddhism as a choice. Here we have people, these new movements are people like, for example, there's a teacher called Goenka. He's a teacher of Vipassana who does 10-day courses, and which is based basically on body sensation. And that is an open, free camp or retreat that goes on. So many, many people are taking that as a part of their interest in Buddhism. I call many of these people Hibus, you know, Hindu Buddhists. Hindu culturally, but Buddhist by practice. Again, you will find there's a group of people called the Soka Gakkai International, who are very much influenced by Nichiren Daishonin from Japan. A very growing movement, very, very strong in terms of setting intentionality, in terms of sangha building, in terms of self-transformation. Again, and a proselytizing group to try to get more people to come onto the path through the chanting of Nammyoho Renge Kyo, which is a particular chant in Japanese. And then you have people like in the tradition that I'm a student of the Venerable Thich Nhat Hanh of Vietnam. And we have a number of sanghas or small groups. We think of sangha as the fourfold sangha, huh? Laymen, laywomen, monks and nuns. So we have sanghas in Delhi and different parts of India now. So there's a sort of a growing movement of intellectuals, middle classes, also interested in this movement. So as I said, the mass, 90% would be the so-called Dalit Buddhists. And I would say the other 8% or so would be traditional Buddhists, including the Tibetans who are here. And then I would say about maybe 1% or 2% are this very new emerging Buddhism that is coming out of a very out of a sort of interest in the scientific temper, in meditation, in mind training, and coming partly also, I should say, from a little bit of a disenchantment with the Hindu caste system, even amongst the intellectuals, and too much guru and too much God.
Khun Chantham, you mentioned about the conversion led by Dr. Ambedkar. You were not born a Buddhist yourself. Can you tell us why did you convert to be a Buddhist?
My background was I was in the corporate world, and then I went to activist politics, and then I burnt out. And so it was all external, you know, agitating type.
Which one burned you more, corporate world or politics?
Sorry?
Which one burned you more?
The politics, the activist politics, actually, that burnt me out more. And so I started looking for peace rather than fighting for peace. I wanted to be peaceful. And so I went to many, many gurus in India, teachers in India, and I found that there were some very good practices. I was very blissed out, ecstatic sometimes with some of the mantra practices and so on. But I found that I wasn't grounded enough, I think. And I slowly started also finding, as I said, too much God and too much guru. Everything at the end of it was, it's in God's hands. So I started looking for Buddhist teachers. And in fact, interestingly, there was nothing in India. I met Goenka ji, luckily, early on. And then I heard that there were some very good teachers in the West Coast of America. So then I went to the West Coast of America and I met Buddhist teachers there. Japanese, Korean, and then I met Vietnamese. And I think what it suited me, why Buddhism suited me, was because of, I think, three or four things. One is that it was about suffering on this world. It wasn't about something hereafter, the kingdom after death or next life. It was about the suffering here and now. And I was very aware of that through my politics. You know, the second element, I think, was the understanding of interconnectedness. I was very critical already of the idea of the soul because it justified the caste system. And so there was a sort of sense of, if you brought up in India, you realize that the caste system is justified by the existence of soul. So I came to it politically, but also through meditation. I mean, not that I'm that advanced a meditator, but I realized that I think it's an idea more than a reality, the idea of soul. I think the third element is the element of self-reliance. I think Buddhism helped me with that because, again, I feel that, you know, like Nehru said, we are dealt a pack of cards in our lives, but it's up to us how we play it. So there's an element of self-reliance. It's not all fatedness. In Hinduism, there's a great, or Brahminism, there's a great sense of fatedness. Everything is here because it was already fated. And I think the fourth element, which is very important, is there's a practice to realize nirvana, moksha, which is the practice, in my case, of mindfulness, or what even Venerable Buddha Dasa or Ajahn Buddha Dasa often emphasized, whether it's through Anapanasati or other teaching. There is a practice of mindfulness that can attain a sense of liberation and freedom. So I think these four points, in a way, help me some way become a Buddhist and then take ordination and etc.
Given the fact that we have many venerable monks with us today, and you mentioned a bit about the emergence of Sangha in India, can you tell us a bit about the roles of Sangha in promoting Buddhism in India at present?
So we have this difference of language for Sangha or understanding of Sangha in the sense that I think of the fourfold Sangha, but I think you're referring to the monastic Sangha. Is that right?
Okay. Yes.
So I would, you know, in the reemergence of Buddhism, I think the role of the Sangha or the monastics is crucial. And especially so in a country like India, where we look at the robe with great veneration, with great respect. It's part of our psychological makeup. When we see a robe, we go like this immediately. So it's part of our DNA, I would say. So in India, you put a painting or you put a bit of yellow or orange on a rock and everyone will start going like this. It's like that. You don't even need to wear it. So I think there is a big role. The problem we have in India, because there's been no training very much of monks, Indian monks. I'm not talking about Tibetans in this case, because even though they're very much part of the Indian family now, I would say there's a huge need for the training, or good training of monks. And the tradition in India, the Hindus who've converted to Buddhism, is that you take on this role late on in life. You know, it's part of the third or fourth stage of life. So most of the monks who are becoming monks in India are much later in life. They're sort of retiring. They're taking this sort of sannyas aspect of life. And so it's pretty tough to train them. So I think we have to really look at young people who are interested to open this door. And I would say not just monks, but nuns. In India, if we have to open the door for nuns, we have to open it now. 10, 20, 50 years from now, we will think of India, Indian Buddhism again, much more conservative in that sense of not opening up to nuns. So my plea is that the monastic Sangha should have nuns and monks, but we have a global responsibility as Buddhists to help that. So I think whether we give training to young people to go to Thailand, or to go to Taiwan, or to Vietnam, we are trying that in a small way. We have a center in France, and we are sending some people there to train to be monastics too.
Dr. Ambedkar once wrote in the book that what he would like is one of his aspirations to see Buddhism being restored back in India. Do you think that we can, you know, see a successful restoration of Buddhism back in India in our lifetime? What are the supporting factors and what are the major challenges?
Yeah, well, I like Dr. Ambedkar's aspiration. That's very good. And I think we hope for that. I think there are two ways of looking at it. One is in terms of people, what you call card-carrying Buddhists, you know, people who say, I'm Buddhist, the label. And the other is people who can imbibe Buddhist values and practice, like we were talking about in education, the Vinaya. You don't have to be a Buddhist to be a Buddhist, in a sense. So I think in the first, I think we can create a revolution. I think in the next even 50 years, we can have about 200 million Buddhists if we work strategically, which is all the Dalits. The Dalits will convert to Buddhism, and it is possible if they see a value in it. So that is one very important, it's a sort of strategic, but we have to think how to work in that way. But in terms of bringing Buddhism in a more, I would say, how do you say, internal way into Indian society, which I think is more important in many ways, we must emphasize education, as we've been talking about, but there are many, many other ways. Because in Indian society, Buddhism already exists. The seed of Buddhism is very deep in our psyche. It requires a little bit of watering. For example, if you look at even the tradition of Buddhism in India, or Buddhist thinking, if you look at politics, the way the Sangha is developed based on the republics of the 6th century BC, or the secular nature of politics, in the sense of not of separation from state and religion. These are sort of ideas of Ashoka, of Buddha, which are very much part of Indian culture. You look at art today, I mean, the oldest art, whether it's stupas or Ashokan pillars, or are all Buddhist. Hindu temples didn't come up until the 3rd century. And this is part of our Indian tradition. We look at ecology, the vegetarianism that goes on in India today, amongst the higher castes even, has come out of Buddhism and Jainism. It wasn't part of the Brahminical movement. And like this, if you look at many, many different elements of our society, Buddhism exists already. It's just sort of underground Buddhism in a way. You know, it's not being saying I'm Buddhist, but actually Buddhism is very much part of our culture. And what we need is if we can get the watering of that Buddhist seed in us, I think a lot of people say, yes, this is what I am. And I think that's part of our responsibility, I think, again.
What are the most difficult obstacles for promoting Buddhism in India?
I think there are a number of obstacles. The first obstacle, I would say, is that it's a political obstacle. What has happened because of Buddhism being aligned with Ambedkar and the Dalit movement is that people say all Buddhists are Dalits. When I say I'm Buddhist, they say, oh, but you're a Dalit. You're not a Dalit. So I think it's now, one of the problems is that we're equating Buddhism with being so-called untouchable. So people don't like to be Buddhist, in one sense. That is one of the challenges. I think another challenge is that there's actually a very deep psychological and mental makeup in India that there is a soul, and that we have rebirth based on that transmigration of soul. And even if you ask a Christian or a Muslim or anybody here, it is very deep in our psyche as Indians. And I think to come to anatma theory, or anatma understanding, is very tough. So even the new groups of Buddhists who are interested are not going to. So I think I would say these are two important elements. And then, of course, there's been a big Brahminical hold. I mean, it's interesting. I heard a comment made when, you know, Professor Samten's institute in Sarnath was being set up. You know, there was one of the great personalities of India who was helping set it up. And she was told, you know, what are you doing bringing Buddhism back? We got rid of that 1,000 years ago. You know, what are you... They're threatened by saying you will break your head. It is that serious. So it is not easy. There's a lot of opposition. But if you use skillful means, and we don't do it antagonistically. You see, what is happening a lot with the Dalit Buddhists also, there's a lot of anger. And yes, it's justified in many ways, but it is becoming antagonism. So for example, in the politics, you will see that the imaging of Buddha is a very, very important imaging for politics. In the Hindu movement, they were trying to create the imaging of Rama in the 90s, early 90s. With, you know, there was a big movement to break a mosque where Ram was born. And so, at the same time, somebody called Mayawati and Kashi Ram, there were people in the Uttar Pradesh, they started using the symbol of Buddha. Now, Buddha is a much more potent symbol, but it's become a political symbol. as opposed to the Ram symbol. So I think these are the sort of difficulties, but they're not insurmountable. And I think my feeling is that there are many, many ways of, skillful ways of bringing Buddhism back to India. Yes.
Okay. There was an article written by Tan Puttathasa, which we have reprinted in the book that we are distributing in this conference. Buddhadasa talk about the indebtedness of Thai people to India. He suggested that the Thai should find ways to pay India back. And one of the major initiatives, or one of the major tasks that the Thai should think about is to help bring Buddhism back to India. In your view, how could the Thai monks, Thai Upasaka Upasika, help in the movement to bring Buddhism back to India?
I put down a few points because we talked about it a little earlier, and I thought that there are lots of different areas. I was just thinking out this question: how do we bring Buddhism back to India, to the land of its source? And I thought there are many areas. We can work with media, we can work with education, we can work with tourism, with research, with social organization, on diplomacy. So I just put down a few ideas. And there may be a little detail, but just thoughts. Okay. One was, for example, in the media, we must get the impression that the Buddha was not a Dalit, but was a regular, was a human being. He was not a god. So I think to recreate that environment, because in India we also think of Buddha, sorry, that is another obstacle. We think of Buddha as a god, as an avatar or incarnation of Vishnu. So bring the humanity back to Buddha. So for that, I think in media we can make a TV serial, we can make movies, we can distribute books, we can translate books into local languages, we can have a Buddha channel, I think, with teachers from different traditions to show that Buddha is not just one flavor of Buddha, but there are many aspects which suit you. And I think so in that sense, I think media can be used. I think in the field of education, crucial, we've talked about it today already. I think the mind training, the spiritual development, that we've heard about the new research on neuroplasticity and epigenetics, hopefully in children. We can do that sort of work on bringing mindfulness and applied ethics to school education. We've just done a whole month program with teachers and children in the last month based on that. And I heard from, again, something that they're starting teacher training courses. So again, a very good method of bringing from the Thai Sangha, from Tibetan Sangha, Buddhist Sangha, of mind training methods back to education. I would say another thing would be, we did a retreat with Dalits, for example. We had 500 Dalits, and we had a 4-day retreat on anger. Again, that's a sort of education. Maybe Buddhist universities, maybe Buddhist schools, we have one. And then I think invitation of good teachers, to India to give talks, to give retreats. In fact, today I'm reminded of a person we organized a talk for some years ago, Larry Rosenberg. He is a teacher in America who wrote the foreword for Buddhadasa's book on mindfulness and breathing. And today is Larry Rosenberg's 80th birthday. So, then the other thing is young people. 52% of India is under 25. Huge potential. We've been working with universities and we call it the wake up movement. And this is making meditation cool. Singing songs, doing other sort of things. It's not just serious, sitting and watching our breath, but really making it cool. So people, young people like it at colleges. Tourism. I think tourism and pilgrimage, very important to revive, not just the places where the Buddha went, but other parts of India which are very historically important, like Maharashtra, Orissa. The whole of India was Buddhist. So by people going to those places, we revive the history in India's minds. We have forgotten that. There's a place in Bombay, it's in Andheri, and it's used as a toilet. It's one of our old rock cut monasteries. We have more than 1,000 rock cut monasteries, and it's being used as a toilet. So we were talking about the relics earlier. I mean, there are lots of ways of really giving value. And then I think, with pilgrimage, people get interested in India, they give support and social services to India, like there's a hospital outside the Kushinagar Wat, in Kushinagar. It's very good. I think that sort of is a good example of what we can do. Research. Very important to do good research on India's Buddhist past. We still don't know why Buddhism disappeared. It's one of those mysteries of history. Again, scientific research, like we're doing in America and England, in India, on neuroplasticity and, you know, those sort of areas and children. You know, why was Buddha made an avatar? You know, and when you read about these stories, he's referenced as not a good guy as an avatar. He's a sort of town antichrist type feeling, you know, persona in the Puranas, in the Hindu texts. Social organization, again, the revival of the monastic tradition, we spoke about that. The revival of the order of nuns. I think supporting of temples and monasteries, setting up centers for mindfulness and other practices, you know, I think crucial that people can touch peace. Building fourfold sangha, the economics, I think supporting Indian Buddhists who do businesses, especially if they're linked to the Dhamma, you know. So I think those sort of things that they feel that they're a worldwide community rather than just and especially the people like Tibetans, the Dalits, other people who are working in this area. I think, you know, I remember talking to a peanut seller outside the Mahabodhi temple. He's a Muslim. So I said, what does Buddha mean to you? He said, he's my God. I said, but you know, you're a Muslim, you have Allah as your God. He said, no, but Buddha gives me my livelihood. So he's my God. He's selling his peanuts to all the tourists. So, you know, we have to engage with people to make them feel that they get benefit from Buddhism, you know, by your coming. And again, with diplomacy, I think diplomacy is a very important vehicle. India has seen the importance of the Look East policy, importance of countries like Thailand and Burma and many of the Buddhist countries. Our greatest link with the East is the Buddha and bamboo to some extent, but Buddha and rice, maybe. Or somebody said cotton. But I think the Buddha is our connection. But India, we've forgotten it. So we don't even look at tourism, we look at Buddhists as sort of potential tourists, you know, not even as pilgrims. So I think we have to look at many, many different levels like this it's very exciting, but I think we can only do it together. And I think if we work, you know, with the Indian Buddhists and the global Buddhists together, we can create Ambedkar's vision or Nehru's vision, or it doesn't have to be any, it's all our vision, I think. It's all our hope that we bring the Buddha Dharma and Buddha Dasa's vision of bringing the Buddha Dharma back to the land of its origin.
Okay. Allow me to ask you one more question so that I will open up to the floor. If you have any questions, you can, you know, ask directly by using a microphone, or you can write your questions up and some people will collect the questions for you. Kunchantam, you talk about the pilgrimage, you know, Buddhist pilgrimage to India, and you also mentioned a number of initiatives. I believe that many of those are related to your Ahimsa organizations and also the Buddha Path organization. Can you tell us a bit about those two organizations?
These two organizations are linked, but they're not doing the same work. Ahimsa Trust is essentially an organization doing both social and development work and also working in bringing mindfulness to school education. So I think this is... we are working with Muslims, Hindus, tribals in village development work, and also trying to bring in mindfulness into education. That is our main two programs. And also distribution of books in Hindi, Marathi, now Tamil, and also English. Mainly around the teachings of Thich Nhat Hanh, but we are very open to other teachers and organizing teachers to come to India. And Buddha Path is an organization which primarily organizes pilgrimages to the Buddhist sites. It was started in 1988. And what I saw was that in India we were going to pilgrimage sites as tourism and not as a practice. And the Buddha was probably the only, or at least the first religious leader in the world who said, go to the sites and will be of great benefit. And so this he really recommended it as a practice. So Buddha Path is essentially it's a company in a way, like a tour company, but organizing meaningful, transformative journeys to Buddhist sites. And now we're also doing interfaith journeys because we're realizing that, you know, Buddhism is made of non-Buddhist elements, Hinduism and Islam, and also to other places. Like this in January, I'm doing a journey to Maharashtra. And we are going to all the ancient rock-cut caves and creating them like places of study and practice, like they were. For a thousand years, they haven't been used like that. So we are going to recreate that sort of energy of the practice in those caves and see what it was like. So it is, I think that's, so Buddha path and Ahimsa trust, they link each other in that way. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. You know, any questions from the floor? Any questions? Yes, yes, Prabhupada-san.
Thank you. You said that there are many groups of Buddhists in India. I would like to know how they are related to each other, like the Abeka Buddhists and the other groups. I was told that they feel that they are abandoned or ignored by the other Buddhists in India and also other Buddhists in the other country. I don't know what is the reality in terms of relationship between Abeka movement, Abeka Buddhists and the other Buddhists.
Thank you. The majority are Abeka Buddhists. So the other Buddhists are, to some degree, pretty much insignificant, except maybe the Tibetan Buddhists who are, but even they have their own issues. So I think to feel a little abandoned by the Indian Buddhists, I would not put too much, because the other Indian Buddhists have no great strength. And the people who have tried to help to some degree, there's not always an opening. I think there's greater opening with Ambedkar Buddhists. I'm calling them Ambedkar because they don't like to be called Ambedkar Buddhists now. They like to be called Buddhists, like we all do like to be called Buddhists. But just for... is that they feel a great affinity with non-Indians sometimes. For example, when Thich Nhat Hanh came to India, we had this... he gave this talk to 250,000 Dalit Buddhists on the Diksha Bhumi. And then we had this retreat for 5 days on anger, 4 days. And then we had a talk to the intellectuals. And it was really well received. And it was very nice. But as a so-called non-Dalit Buddhist, we are not trusted as much. So we can do work from the back. So for example, we do a lot of work with trying to do book publications in languages which are suitable to the Dalit Buddhist. But we don't come in front. We let the Dalit Buddhist come in front. There's also, I think, some degree of feeling of, we have to be careful. I found this with some of my Western friends. They feel they found a new cause in the world to bring Buddhism back to India through Ambedkar Buddhism. We have to be very careful what we are doing with that. How we understand, because they are coming to Buddhism through Ambedkar. So we must read the book, Buddha and His Dhamma, understand what is the pedagogical approach to Buddhism, and then if you understand it well and you support that, then it's fine. But I think for many of us, we have to also try and offer other options of practice. And there are groups. There's the Sangha Rakshata group, they call it TBMSG. There's a man called Lokamitra who's been helping with that, an Englishman, doing very good work, trying to bring metta bhavana meditation for many years. But he's found it very difficult to work there also. So I think it's a difficult group to work with. But there's a great need, and I think it's also our responsibility. So it's a challenge. I don't know if I'm answering your question, but it's a challenge for all of us to work with a Buddhism which many of us don't necessarily subscribe to. If you subscribe to suffering coming from outside, it becomes a political movement. If you subscribe to that, then the whole life story of the Buddha changes, why he left home is different. So I think we have to look at all the Buddhists as brothers and sisters, but we have to see what you can offer. You're not going to change your Buddhism to suit somebody else. I mean, you have to come to share what you know best and what gives you happiness and gives you liberation. And I think if they're open to that, great. Besides the funding is only one element. The funding is a dangerous element, because funding can go either which way. You know, there's a lot of, it develops greed and develops, you know, that's another whole story of potentiality in Indian Buddhism, so especially with the Dalit movement. So, and I've seen that. So, and the other small groups also. There's a group called the Shakyas who are now near Sankasya, who are trying to reclaim their Buddhist past in some way by saying that they were Shakyas from the Buddha's time there are people who any surname with Mer is becoming a Maurya or is becoming a Kolya. There's a whole underground movement. In fact, today, though the census says about 8 million Buddhists, I would say they're probably more like 20, 25 million. Many people, especially below the sort of radar, are becoming Buddhists. And I think for that, we have to support livelihood issues, we have to support the monastic training, we have to support education, but not necessarily just funding, you know?
Shantam, you mentioned about, you know, another big movement on Buddhism in India is definitely Tibetan Buddhism. We're delighted to have the presence of Most Venerable Geshe Ngawang Samten with us this afternoon. Please allow me to invite you to the stage and ask Most Venerable Geshe to talk to us or explain to us about the movements of Tibetan Buddhism. Venerable Geshe Samten has been very instrumental in promoting the study of Tibetan Buddhism in India. And he's now with the Saranath, University of Tibetan Studies in Saranath. Geshe, perhaps you could explain to us the current stage of Tibetan Buddhism movement in India.
I don't think there is a Tibetan movement, a Tibetan Buddhist movement as such. His Holiness's arrival in India itself was a incident, and it happened due to the situation in Tibet, due to Tibet's occupation by China, and this is how His Holiness came to India and sought refuge, and he was followed by about 80,000 Tibetan people. And in which there were many great scholars and practitioners and students at that time. And so eventually when His Holiness, thought that in order to maintain the Tibetan identity as such, so he thought that the Tibetan lay people should have their own settlements where they can, settle themselves and to maintain their own identity. And at the same time, the Tibetan study, Tibetan education, monastic education should be maintained, and the tradition should be maintained. For that, many of the monasteries in Tibet were re-established in India, where there used to be, in one single monastery, there used to be more than 10,000 monks studying. In India, those were re-established, and in them, in the beginning, there were a few hundred monks, and then eventually, now these days, there are about 3,000 to 4,000 monks studying in those monasteries. So eventually, many of the monasteries got re-established, and many of these, in these monasteries, the education system, the study system were maintained as we had in Tibet. For example, in Geshe is the title of our education, which we obtain after completing our education, and which takes from 25 to 30 years, or sometimes even 35 years of time to complete that education. So, which involves the study of Vinaya, study of Abhidhamma, study of meditations, and the study of logic, study of epistemology, study of psychology, and study of many other fields. And so that takes a long time, and they have to study very rigorously for 25 to 30 years of time. And this is the kind of education system that we have maintained, which actually this tradition came from Nalanda, Vikramashila, and Takshashila, and this tradition is still being maintained by the Tibetan, Tibetan community. And to tell you in brief that the Tibetan tradition, which is known as the Tibetan tradition, is a tradition that we received from Nalanda tradition, where not only the Pali tradition was studied, as His Holiness mentioned this morning, but also the Sanskrit tradition, and belonging to so many other fields of studies were studied. Not only the religious and religious and meditative the subjects were studied, but also secular, many of the secular subjects were studied, like astronomy, astrology, grammar, poetry, and you know, arts, meteorology, dramaturgy. Many of these were also studied in those great monastic universities. That is why the Nalanda and Vikramshila, these were the you know institutions on the pattern of which the modern university concept got developed. The first university in the West was Bologna University, which was established in 11th century, which was built on the pattern of the university education system that you know India had at that time, which was like Nalanda and other monastic universities, in which in one campus so many different kinds of fields of studies were studied, and the one single you know person can study different fields of studies on their own choice. So that kind of tradition was imported to Tibet, and in the course of importing this tradition to Tibet, Tibetans went through so many hardships. Hundreds and hundreds of Tibetan scholars and the students came to India to study, and hundreds of Indian masters were invited to Tibet. And in that process, you know, thousands of texts were translated from Pali, from a few from Pali, and the most of them from Sanskrit, and then many of them from Prakrit languages were, you know, the texts were translated, Buddha's, you know, words, and the works of the Indian masters were translated, which amounts to be more than, you know, around 5,000, you know, titles were translated into Tibetan language. And then later, the Tibetan masters have, you know, written thousands and thousands of commentary works and independent works on the basis of the Buddha's teachings and Indian masters' works. And so this is how the Tibetan, you know, the tradition got developed and preserved and maintained, and this is still going on in India. And this is what you can say, that the Tibetan, you know, Buddhist tradition, which is maintained in exile, and mainly in exile, mainly in India, and we also have many monasteries in Nepal, and now flourishing in many Western countries as well.
Thank you very much, most honorable Khechen. We have about 7 more minutes. I think we could have time for a few more questions from the floor. Yes, there's one venerable in Kunichada, and there's another question in the back. So there are 3 questions. There's a venerable here.
Often it's asked the connection or the difference between Hinduism and Buddhists, and I would like some comments from both of you who live in this country. You are Indian, Chandan. That often from a Buddhist perspective, the Buddha kind of perfectionized Hinduism. From a Buddhist perspective, that's a kind of very common understanding. And from a Hindu perspective, often what I hear is, oh, the Buddha was just another incarnation of Krishna. So could you comment on this kind of very common view of how is that or facilitating real understanding in terms of the inter-religious dialogue between these great traditions?
In interest of the time, maybe we hear all the 3 questions and answer them at the same time. Mm-hmm.
I have a question about Ambika Buddhism. Because some years ago I was told that there is a big community of Ambika Buddhism in Pune. I would like to know that how this big community put Buddhism or Buddhist teaching into the practice or in their daily life.
And there is another question from, please raise your hand at the back.
Good evening, Your Venerable and Mr. Santum. My name is Doramon Paptanti. I'm a Rotary Peace Fellow studying peace peace studies, and I came from Tokyo to attend this event. So thank you very much for your chance to give me the opportunity to ask the questions.
Stand up, please.
Okay. My question is, you mentioned several times on politics and Buddhism, and actually political movements and social movements. So my question is to do with Buddhism and politics, and how today, I think there are several examples that Buddhism or actually faith-based organizations or Buddhism organization can become an instrument, if using in a bad way, of political interests. So how would Buddhism position itself or prevent from being used as political instruments by those who are in power? How would prevent from that situations, and to mobilize people in a good way and not being used as political instruments? That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you.
The question was about the Buddha being the reincarnation of Shiva, right? The Vishnu. Yes, there are. I think the very, very concept of, there are some very serious scholars who say that this very idea of Buddha being the incarnation of Vishnu crept into the Hindu kind of system in about a few centuries, several centuries back, when Buddhism was very much flourishing in India. So at that time, it was a kind of idea that developed, and so eventually, this kind of idea flourished. And as a Buddhist, we never say that. We never say that Buddhist, and there is not a single line in any, not let alone the Buddha Vajina, but also in any of the Indian masters, thousands of the treatises and works. Not a single line, even a half line, saying that Buddha is an incarnation of Vishnu, right? So from Buddhist side, we never accept that. But from the Hindus, they, so therefore, many of the Hindus respect Buddha. Of course, in India, as Mr. Shantam has said, that in India, there is a tendency of, respecting all the religious, persons. And all the religious traditions. And so when they see Buddha's statue, they venerate. And another reason of venerating, for many of the Hindus, venerating Buddha is because Buddha being the incarnation of Vishnu. Right? So with respect to the, I think instead of the politicians politicizing the Buddhist organization and Buddhist system, I think the Buddhists should spiritualize the politicians, right? So we should be able to maintain the polarizations. And if we are being used by the politicians, then it is our weakness. So we should be more powerful enough to spiritualize them rather than being, utilizing us and politicizing the Buddhist organizations, right? This is what I feel.
Thank you, Keshe. And the questions on Ambika, right?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I think on the first question, I'd like to say that if you notice in India, even though Buddha is an avatar of Vishnu, there is no Buddhist temple built by Hindu. And it's a good question to ask, why? And also, people will not keep a Buddha statue in their house. For different reasons, the children will leave the house. So there's a lot of superstition around the Buddha. And as I was mentioning in the Purans, the persona of the Buddha is not in a complimentary way. So he drew away people with his false teachings. That is how he is perceived. So in many ways, but we have to look at it historically, that there was a very different movement. There was a Brahminical movement and a Shramana movement. And Buddha and Mahavira and all come out of the Shramana movement. They don't come out as people who are trying to cleanse Hinduism. It's a very different movement. So we don't see them as some sort of, reform movement at all. And out of that comes a different view. And so at a certain point, they have ascendancy. And then because of
politics or other reasons, they have a descendancy. But in fact, even great Indian teachers or Hindu teachers like Shankara, his guru, his godfather guru, Gaudapada, was a Buddhist in some ways. I mean, he was, they said, Shankara, the 8th century philosopher who really, in a way, revived Hinduism, Brahmanism in India, was influenced very deeply by the Yogacara school. And he brought those things into Hinduism. And so I think it was a masterstroke in some way to make the Buddha into an avatar of Vishnu. And I think India is like that. India is an accumulator. It assimilates things. You know, and if Christ had been around a bit earlier, India would be, you see, you go to Buddhist Hindu temple, you see a picture of Christ also there, isn't it? No problem. You know, now there's Mother Teresa has come up also. So it's all, we have no problem. So I think that's part of our sort of tradition we accumulate. But I think there's also an insidiousness, and we have to be careful, because if you, basically the Atma and Atma dialogue is going to carry on. And that's, it's not easily reconcilable. It is reconcilable in some meditative and mystical traditions, and like Ramana Maharishi and many other Advaita Vedanta traditions, which you're probably aware of, but it's an issue. So that's one area, and I think it should be reconciled. It's reconciled in our own hearts, but not politically, so it has to be recognized through practice. I think with the question with Ambedkar Buddhism, I think Ambedkar Buddhists, to a large degree, though they've had some sort of affirmative action in India because of the so-called reservations, they're upwardly mobile, but still many of them are poor, and I think one of the ways to help is to give economic support. And Dhamma support, like I mentioned earlier, is through books, through teachings, spending time, getting to know people, and spending time in their homes and their vihar, and setting up, you know, places for them to practice. I think bringing the good Dhamma from Thailand is a wonderful practice. And I think your question is well answered by Samdong Rinpoche. You know, he said, you know, oppose any injustice, but don't get in party politics. I think, you know, we cannot make Buddhism into an instrument or a political party. But we have to, if we follow the Vinaya, we have to oppose injustice and violence. So I think in that sense, that question was answered earlier too.
Thank you very much. In the interest of the time, I'm afraid that we have to draw this session to the end. It has been very informative. Thank you very much to Most Venerable Geshen Nawang Samtent and Mr. Shankham Set for giving us a very good understanding about the current state of Buddhism in India. Thank you very much again.
I know we're short of time, but in the tradition of Ajahn Buddhadasa, can we just have about a minute of silence before we end? I just invite the bell, we just follow our breath. Just for 1 minute, because I think there's been so much talking that I think we just, I just invite a bell for 1 minute.
Yes,
just,
okay. Yeah, that's very good.
Thank you very much, Dr. Veerathai and most venerable Geshe-la Wang and Chantham Set for a very informative session. We have to leave the room right now, but before that, tomorrow, just 1 minute meditation not enough. So tomorrow from 5:30 in the morning, may I invite all of you, all of us to be here. Geshe, most venerable Geshe Lakdo will lead the meditation. About 1.5 hours here, and the guidelines will be ready for you here, and also a bag for your shoes is ready here also. And after this, there is some or your tailor-made program, but for venerables, not only Thai but also Geshe and others' friends who are very really want to contribute to collaboration in Buddhism between our friend in India, our Tibetan, and also most venerable are invited to be on the sixth floor in the Regency Club. But that can accompany around 60. The monks are almost occupied. And Nampana is already be served there, so you can go up at right now, and anytime you are ready, there's the attendant to receive you to the room. So, and there is two main topics that will be discussion upstairs. The first one may be about what should be collaboration with our Indian friend, especially the Tibetan Sangha here. And second one, what should we do when we go back to Thailand. Thank you very much. อย่าลืมนะครับคำถามนะครับสำหรับคำถามพรุ่งนี้ถ้าจะต้องถามจะอยากจะได้ถามคุณอินทร์ใช่ไหมวิทยุพบไว้กับท่านนะครับวิทยุนี้ขอให้ท่านเอากลับไปถึงประเทศไทยท่านไม่คิดว่าจะใช้แล้วช่วยฮิ้วไปให้ถึงประเทศไทยแล้วส่งกลับที่หอจดหมายเหตุพุทธทาสอินทปัญโญเพื่อเราจะใช้ในงานอื่นต่อเพราะถ้ารับที่นี่เลยแล้วแพ็กไปจะมีปัญหาเรื่องการเอาเข้าประเทศและการออกเดี๋ยวเขาต้องชิบภาษีวายนะวิทยุกรุณาพบกลับแล้วก็ไม่ใช้ก็แวะไปทิ้งไปเป็นสิ่งที่หอจดหมายเหตุ
เราไปไหนไม่ได้ต้องรอพวกรวยอยู่เนาะ